So today's video is going to be something a bit different. Instead of talking about the engineering behind an existing theme park attraction, I thought it might be interesting to do a deep dive on a personal project that I've been working on, which combines roller coaster design with artificial intelligence. AI is an exciting branch of computer science that I have been really interested in lately, and I wanted to try an experiment to see if I could teach an AI program how to generate track layouts. Designing a fun and thrilling layout is something that is well suited for the human brain because it involves a high level of creativity and reasoning, and these are both cognitive abilities that cannot be replicated by a computer. In contrast to the human brain, artificial intelligence tends to work in a more structured and predictable manner using algorithms and programming. However, it can be trained to complete a given task in an optimized way through the process of machine learning. My initial thinking was that if it is possible to teach an AI how to design a roller coaster, then in theory, it should be possible for it to come up with the most optimal layout within a specified area. It turns out that this task is much more difficult in practice though, since designing a track layout is a multi-objective optimization problem with several conflicting objectives, and it's nearly impossible to define what an optimal roller coaster looks like compared to a bad one. Unfortunately, there's no mathematical equation that can calculate how fun a roller coaster is based on its physical attributes like speed and g-force, and such an equation would be useless anyway, because fun is something that is entirely subjective. Despite this, I was able to work around the problem to build an artificial intelligence program that I've called Coaster AI, which can design simple 2D roller coasters using a genetic machine learning algorithm. The designs that it comes up with are not necessarily the most optimal by definition, but they are completely generated by AI, and it has even invented some brand new roller coaster elements that have never been built before. Today, I would like to show you exactly how this program works, and I'm going to explain how you can use machine learning to teach a computer how to design a roller coaster. To start, I think it's helpful to differentiate between what is artificial intelligence and what is machine learning, since these terms are similar but not exactly the same. Basically, machine learning is a subset of artificial intelligence that is responsible for actually achieving a state of AI, whereas AI itself describes the end product of machine learning, where a computer or machine exhibits intelligent behavior. To create artificial intelligence, you first need some type of machine, program, or bot that is capable of performing a specific task, albeit quite randomly in the beginning, and a machine learning algorithm is then used to teach the bot how to perform the task in an optimized way. So to make an AI program that can design roller coasters, you need to start by creating a bot that is able to generate random track splines, and you need to train it so that it understands which spline shapes make up a good roller coaster design, and which spline shapes make up a bad one. To accomplish this, the program needs to consist of four key components which I've broken down as follows. A method for generating splines using a bot that is comprised of a neural network, a basic physics engine for computing things like velocity, acceleration, and g-force, a rating system that provides a quantitative score for each roller coaster design, and a machine learning algorithm that trains the program and optimizes its behavior. I am going to run through each of these, focusing primarily on the AI and machine learning components, starting with spline generation using a neural network. A neural network is essentially the brain of the AI, and it is inspired by the arrangement of neurons in a human brain with several layers of interconnected nodes. Every neural network has one input layer and one output layer, and there can be any number of intermediate layers in the middle called hidden layers, in this case two. The number of nodes in the input and output layers depends on the given problem being solved, while the number of nodes in each hidden layer can be adjusted to alter the behavior of the network. Every node can hold a single numerical value, and each line connecting two nodes represents a mathematical computation to get from one to the next. To see how this works, let's consider the first node of hidden layer 1, which is connected to all four nodes in the previous input layer. In order to compute the value of this node, we start by multiplying each input by a numerical weight, and then we sum all of these together and add a bias value. This is basically just a sum of linear equations in the form y equals mx plus b, where each weight represents the slope of a line, and the bias represents the total translation. We can repeat this for the second node of hidden layer 1 using a different set of weights and biases, and then again for every other node until we have completed the entire layer. The process is exactly the same to get from hidden layer 1 to hidden layer 2, and then from hidden layer 2 to the output layer, with the only difference being the number of nodes and computations. Now this is obviously quite a bit of algebra just to get from 4 input values to 1 output value, but fortunately we can simplify it down to just a few lines using vectors and matrices. If we represent each layer of the network as a vector, then we can get from one layer to the next simply by multiplying the previous vector by a matrix of weights and adding a vector of biases. This makes the computations a lot easier to handle, especially when coding a neural network in a computer program. It is also desirable to normalize all the values in order to help with convergence when running a machine learning algorithm, and so we can apply the hyperbolic tangent function here to compress the value of each node between -1 and +1. This will allow us to optimize the network faster later on, because we only have to deal with values that are contained within a small fixed range, as opposed to any possible number. At this point, you may be wondering what any of this has to do with designing a roller coaster, so now let's see how we can use this neural network to generate a track spline. To begin, we need to pick a starting point where the coaster has a known velocity, height, energy, and track angle, and we need to choose a node spacing that will discretize the track into a finite number of segments. We then take the initial parameters and normalize them between -1 and +1, and we feed them into the neural network as the input layer. The number that comes out the other end as an output is converted to an angle in radians, and we use this as the track angle for the next segment. The angle is measured relative to the previous segment rather than from a fixed reference frame, and I found that it is helpful to limit it to a specified range, such as ±30 degrees, in order to avoid sudden changes in direction. Using the angle and segment length, we can now use a bit of geometry and physics to find the velocity, height, and energy at the subsequent node, which we can then normalize again and send back through the same neural network to get a new angle for the next segment. The same process is repeated over and over until the track spline reaches a certain length or until the roller coaster runs out of energy. In order to automate this, the spline generation sequence is coded into an algorithm that is executed by a bot, where the neural network essentially acts as the bot's brain. Its behavior is determined by the weight and bias values contained within the neural network, and it will make different decisions that result in different spline shapes, depending on how these values are changed. From here, you might be able to see that it is possible to train the bot by attempting to optimize the weights and biases, but first we need a physics engine and a rating system to evaluate the quality of the track splines. I'm not going to spend too much time talking about roller coaster physics here, since I have already covered this in other videos, but I do want to give a brief overview of how the calculations work. The physics engine itself is basically just an algorithm that traverses along a given spline, and it uses the law of conservation of energy to compute the roller coaster's velocity at every node. In order to account for losses, it calculates the amount of work done by rolling friction and aerodynamic drag along each track segment, and it subtracts these values from the total energy. In addition, the algorithm also needs to find the radius of curvature, which is required to compute centripetal acceleration and g-force. There are a few different methods that can be used to do this, but I found that the most reliable way is to use Menger curvature, which works by fitting a perfect circle to every set of 3 points. This provides an approximate solution, as opposed to an exact solution that could be found using derivatives. However, it is still quite accurate as long as the node spacing is relatively small. Once the radius of curvature and velocity are known, the centripetal acceleration can then be calculated at every node, along with the total g-force that the passengers would experience on the ride. All of this information gets stored in a series of vectors as the algorithm traverses along the track, and after it reaches the end, the compiled physics data is then passed on to the rating system. This part of the program is responsible for giving each track design a numerical score, similar to the rating system in the Roller Coaster Tycoon computer game, and it's one of the most challenging components to get right in order for the machine learning process to work properly. Like I mentioned at the beginning of the video, there is no single equation that can define how fun a roller coaster is, and there are countless ways that you could go about evaluating a roller coaster since it tends to be very subjective. For Coaster AI, I wanted the scoring system to be as objective as possible while still providing a level of customization, and although the one that I came up with is far from perfect, it does give satisfactory results in most cases with only 5 basic criteria. These are speed, g-force, steepness or slope, boundary constraints such as maximum or minimum height, and inversions. To generate a score for a given track spline, the speed, g-force, and slope values are first normalized at every node, and each one is multiplied by a weight that is assigned to the corresponding parameter. The scoring algorithm then traverses along the spline and it adds each weighted value to the total score, but only if that value does not violate a constraint. If the speed or g-force falls outside of an allowable range, then the non-compliant value will not contribute to the score, and instead, the algorithm will apply a deduction. A deduction will also be applied for every node that violates a boundary constraint, as well as for any node that violates the law of conservation of energy. Once all of the numbers are added together, the final result is a single score that represents the overall quality of the design. The process itself is fairly straightforward here, but the tricky part is fine-tuning the weights and deductions so that the rating system is well-balanced. If one of the parameters is weighted too high, then the AI will learn to maximize that parameter only while ignoring all the other constraints. And if a parameter is weighted too low, then the AI will simply ignore it. In order to get the best results, the initial weights need to be set up so that each parameter has a nearly equal contribution to the total score, and small adjustments can then be made to control how the AI learns. For example, if we want it to design a roller coaster with more g-forces, then we can assign a slightly higher weight to the g-force parameter, or if we want it to design steeper hills, then we can assign a slightly higher weight to the steepness parameter. Now, teaching the AI to make inversions is a little more difficult, but I found that it is doable by switching between two different rating systems, where one has an added incentive for creating a closed loop. Unfortunately, this isn't the most ideal solution because the incentive needs to be so high that it throws off the balance of the other parameters. However, it does work well enough most of the time until I can come up with a better method. So to briefly recap up to this point, we currently have a bot that can generate a random track spline using a neural network, and we also have a physics engine to analyze that spline, as well as a rating system to quantify how well it meets our criteria for a good roller coaster. The last thing that we need to complete the program is now a machine learning algorithm, which we will use to train the bot so it can learn how to make the best possible design. This is basically just an optimization problem, and our ultimate goal here is to find some combination of weights and biases within the neural network that will allow it to produce a track spline with the highest possible score. One way to train the bot is to simply change the weights and biases at random until it eventually gives a good result. However, this is extremely inefficient, and it would take far too long for the values to converge at an optimal solution. Instead, it is much more effective to use a genetic machine learning algorithm, which is based on the biological theory of evolution. With a genetic algorithm, we start by creating an entire population of bots, and we then exploit the process of natural selection by passing down the best traits from one generation to the next. In other words, we are not really teaching a bot how to design a roller coaster, but rather we are incentivizing a group of bots to evolve so that they become better at designing roller coasters naturally. If everything works correctly, then after a certain number of generations, we should end up with at least one top performing bot that we can say is artificially intelligent. To start the machine learning process, we first select the number of bots that we want to have in our population, and for each one, we generate a neural network with completely random weights and biases. We then allow each bot to create its own track spline using some given input parameters and constraints, and these are passed through the physics engine and rating system so that each design receives a score. This part can be quite computationally intensive depending on how many bots we have, but the greater the population size, the less generations we will need to find an optimal solution. From here, the top performing bots that rank in the top 10% are carried forward to the next generation, while all the others are left behind and discarded. The top performers are then replicated multiple times in order to fill the top half of generation 2. However, each copy undergoes some mutations, so that it becomes a slight variation of the original. This is done by taking a probabilistic approach, where we go through the neural network of each bot and make small random changes to the weights and biases. Each one is assigned a given mutation probability, and the magnitude of each mutation is limited to some percentage of the initial value. Two random variables are then generated for every weight and bias within the network, where the first one determines whether a mutation will occur, and the second one determines the magnitude. By adjusting the mutation probability and limit, we can control how fast or slow we want the bots to evolve between generations, and to what extent. Now, moving to the bottom half of generation 2, we populate this section by generating a new set of bots with brand new neural networks, which introduces a bit of extra randomness. This basically just helps to prevent us from getting stuck in a local maxima of our optimization problem, so we don't end up trying to optimize a single spline shape that is actually a subpar solution. With our second generation complete, we can use the new population to generate a new set of track splines, and from here, the whole cycle can repeat over and over until we reach a specified number of generations, or until we find a roller coaster design that we are satisfied with. Even though the ultimate goal of a genetic algorithm is optimization, in this case, it can also be a useful tool for finding new types of elements that are simply unique or interesting. To see the machine learning process in action, we can take a look at the coaster AI program that I've built in MATLAB, which combines everything from this video together. Down the left are the input parameters and constraints for generating splines. At the top right are the genetic algorithm and mutation parameters for machine learning. And at the bottom right are the weight modifiers for the scoring criteria. Once these are set, we can go ahead and hit run to start the program, and the top figure will begin plotting the best results from each generation. Here, the blue line represents the spline that currently has the highest score, while the orange lines represent all the splines in the top 10%, along with the respective mutations. This allows us to visually see how the AI is learning as it tries to find the most optimal spline shape with the given parameters. At the same time, the bottom window displays the top 5 corresponding scores from each generation, and when the program is terminated, it also gives us some stats for the final roller coaster design and lets us know if it violates any constraints. If we are satisfied with the design, then the spline can be exported to other roller coaster modeling software such as NoLimits, or we can discard it and try running the program again. I'm going to put a download link for Coaster AI in the description for anyone that wants to try it out, and I'm also going to include a simplified version that can run directly in MATLAB, as well as a printout of the script for anyone that just wants to see what the code looks like. It can be a little tedious to get the settings dialed in, and there's a couple of bugs that I'm still trying to work out with the rating system, but it is still possible to get some pretty cool results with a bit of patience and fine-tuning. I think one of the most important accomplishments so far is actually getting the program to design vertical loops, since this is something that typically requires complex physics and math formulas. By using a genetic algorithm, Coaster AI can learn how to make optimal loop shapes that are almost identical to the modern teardrop shapes that are commonly used today, which just goes to show that it is possible to design roller coasters with artificial intelligence. From here, the next step is to expand the program so that it can string multiple elements together, and eventually, I would like to try building a more advanced AI that can create a full track layout in 3D. Designing roller coasters has turned out to be a very interesting application of AI with some unique challenges, and I really have to thank my patrons for allowing me to put so much time into it so far, as well as today's sponsor, NordVPN. Using a VPN is one of the best ways to protect your personal information online, because it allows you to browse the internet anonymously by routing your connection through an encrypted tunnel. This helps to prevent your ISP and third parties from tracking the websites you visit, and NordVPN doesn't keep any data logs. In addition to security, a VPN can also be useful for accessing geo-restricted content that may not be available in your region, such as certain videos on YouTube and online streaming services like Netflix and Disney+. All you have to do is click on a country where the content is available, and in seconds, you can browse the internet and watch movies as if your device was actually located there. NordVPN has servers all over the world with no data caps, so you are free to enjoy unlimited content from anywhere. I highly recommend that you try them out by going to nordvpn.com/artofengineering, where they are currently offering a huge discount on a 2-year plan. It's completely risk-free with their 30-day money-back guarantee, and if you sign up now, you can also get one extra month for free. NordVPN is a service that I personally use myself, and they always help me out by sponsoring these larger projects, so please go check them out at nordvpn.com/artofengineering using the link in the description. You can also support this channel and everything I do over on Patreon, or simply by leaving a like and hitting subscribe below. I hope that you found this video educational and inspiring, and as always, thanks for watching.